Good afternoon. And welcome to this important moment in our Holy Week celebration. One noteworthy aspect of the services held by the Church during the Triduum is that the individual services have no definite beginning or end. Last evening's celebration of Holy Thursday concluded with the stripping of the sanctuary in silence. Please now stand as Father George returns to the sanctuary.
Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
His appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes, we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Call.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he has heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
He answered,
I am not.
Now the servants and the officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter was also with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered them,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue and in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, exclaiming,
Is this how you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself, and they said to him, a kinsman of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, insisted,
Did I not see you in the garden with him?
Peter, once again, denied it. And at once the cock crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was early. They themselves did not enter the praetorium so they might not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
What accusation do you bring against this man?
They answered him,
Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law.
Then the Jews said to him,
It is not lawful for us to put any man to death.
This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken to show by what death he was to die. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?
Pilate answered,
Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the Jews. But my kingship is not from the world.
Pilate said to him,
So you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
After he had said this, he went over to the Jews again and said to them,
I find no crime in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. Will you have me release you, the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this man, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him, and the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying,
Hail, King of the Jews.
with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them,
Behold, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no crime in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
Here is the man.
When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no crime in him.
The Jews answered him,
We have a law, and by that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God.
When Pilate heard these words, he was the more afraid. He entered the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
But Jesus gave no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
You will not speak to me. Do you know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?
Jesus answered,
You would have no power over me unless it had been given from above. Therefore he who delivered me to you had the greater sin.
Upon this, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews kept shouting,
If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king sets himself against Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the pavement. And in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews,
Here is your king.
They cried out,
Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross to the place called the Place of the Skull, which is in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote a title and put on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. The chief priests of the Jews then said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, I am King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and made four parts, one for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was without seam, woven from top to bottom. So they said to one another,
Let us not tear it.
This is to fulfill the scripture. They parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. So the soldiers did this, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, in fulfillment of the scripture,
"I thirst."
A bowl full of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of vinegar on the hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus received the vinegar, he said,
"It is finished."
And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Please kneel. Please rise.
Spices, according to the Jewish custom. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, where no one had been laid. Because of the Jewish day of preparation, as the tomb was close at hand, there they laid Jesus.
For the church, let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord will be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and will grant that, leading a life of quiet and peace, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
We pause in silence. Almighty and everlasting God, who in Christ reveal your glory to all nations, watch over the works of your mercy that your church spread throughout the whole world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the Pope, let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord who chose him for the order of bishops will keep him safe and unharmed for his holy shepherd to shepherd church, to shepherd the holy people of God.
In silence we pray. Almighty everlasting God, on whose decree all things are founded, look favorably on our prayers, and in your faithfulness protect the Pope chosen for us, that the Christian people governed by you, their Maker, may under him as pontiff grow in the merits of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For all orders and degrees of the faithful, let us pray also for our Bishop, Bishop of Rome, for all bishops, priests, deacons of the church, and for the whole community of the faithful.
We pray in silence. Almighty everlasting God, whose spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear us as we humbly pray for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace we may faithfully serve them all, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the local church, let us pray, dear brothers and sisters, for the particular needs of our world today, that God will guide all nations in the ways of peace and justice.
We pray in silence. Almighty, ever-living God, who have created humanity in your great love, graciously grant that the leaders of nations may work together for the common good, so that all may flourish under your loving care, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For catechumens, let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord will open wide the ears of their inmost ears and the gate of mercy, that through the waters of rebirth, having received forgiveness of all their sins, they too may be found in Christ Jesus our Lord.
In silence we pray. Almighty everlasting God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the unity of all Christians, let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord will be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them and keep them safe in his one church.
In silence we pray. Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look tenderly on the flock of your Son, that those who in one baptism have consecrated to you may be joined in the integrity of faith and united by the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the Jewish people, let us pray also for the Jewish people to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he will grant them to advance in love in his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
In silence we pray. Almighty ever-living God, who bestow your promises on Abraham and his seed, listen favorably to the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For those who do not believe in Christ, let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
We pray in silence. Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that as they walk before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth. And as we ourselves grow constantly in mutual love and strive to understand more fully the mystery of your life, make us more perfect witnesses to your charity in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For those who do not believe in God, let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with a sincere heart, they may find the way to God himself.
In silence we pray. Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your faithful love and the witness of good works done by those who believe in you, and so rejoice to confess you the true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For all in public office, let us pray also for all those in public office, that our God and Lord will guide their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of everyone.
In silence we pray. All-powerful God, in whose hand are human hearts and the rights of peoples, look with favor on those in authority of governors, that everywhere throughout the earth, the prosperity of peoples, the security of peace and freedom of religion, may by your gift be assured, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For those in tribulation, let us pray, dearly beloved, to God, the Father Almighty, that he will purge the world of all errors, banish disease, dispel hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, free human traffickers, and grant safety to travelers, return to pilgrims, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
We pray in silence. Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of those who toil, let the prayers of those who cry out from any tribulations come before you, that all may rejoice because in time of need your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
For the Synod of Bishops on the Family, let us pray, dear brothers and sisters, for the upcoming Synod of Bishops, that our good and gracious Lord will bless the human family and teach us to walk in his ways.
In silence we pray. Almighty ever-living God, you know our hearts, for you made us your own. Send your Spirit upon the church, watch over our families, and teach us to follow the path that leads to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. Please stand. This is the word of the cross, on which has hung our salvation. Come, let us
thank you.
We invite you to come as families, as couples, as individuals, however you've come to church today, to come and venerate the cross. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sins. Blessed are we who are called the Supper of the Lamb.
Thank you.
Almighty everlasting God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, safeguard within us the work of your mercy, that through participation in this mystery, we may live in unceasing devotion to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the Lord is with you.
Amen.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May abundant blessing, Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have recalled the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. Let pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless us and our families, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration is ended. Let us go in the peace of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.